Okay, let's talk application layer protocols. First one up is HTTP. So, first up, we're going to talk a little bit about the web. What is the web? What is hypertext, the thing that's being transferred in the hypertext transfer protocol? And how does the web work specifically using HTTP? So, something you may not know is that the internet and the web are not the same thing. The World Wide Web is just a part of the internet. It's a part of what goes on the internet. There's a lot of protocols on the internet that are not a part of the web. For example, your video games. If you have a video game that uses a network, it's not using the World Wide Web. It's using other protocols that run on the internet, but not on the World Wide Web. The same goes for email, although that's a little bit different now that we use so many webmail clients. But the protocols that make email work, sending and receiving email on the back end, are not part of the World Wide Web. They are separate. They're part of the internet, but not the World Wide Web. The World Wide Web refers specifically to HTTP and the protocols, basically what you're going to see through your browser. And there's a lot of things that happen on the internet that don't happen through that web browser, just to clarify here. So let's talk about the web. I've got a whole bunch of links here. I'll pull up a few of them. Let's start off with the first important piece of history, the world's first website. This is still online at CERN, where Tim Berners-Lee created the web. The world's first web page is right here. You can click it. You can look around. We can right-click in Chrome here and view the source and see the source code of the world's first web page. Pretty awesome. Okay, now let's open up a good old piece of history, the Space Jam website. Warner Brothers has kept this one online. You can click around. I don't know if these links still work. Let's try one. They do, and it looks like they link to the modern site as opposed to the Warner Studio store that was originally linked there. That's one more classic, the Million Dollar Homepage. You're welcome to check out the other ones there. Million Dollar Homepage, if you don't recall, or if you didn't know, this guy in 2004, 2005 had the idea to sell pixels on his webpage, $1 per pixel. And his webpage is a million pixels, so it made him $1 million, and he sold every pixel on this web page. As you can see in the top right there, it's sold out. Really cool stuff. So this is Web 1.0, the original web, basically more or less as envisioned by Tim Berners-Lee. So the web was linked documents, and hypertext is documents that link to each other. And that's all hypertext means, is documents that link to each other. So really, the hugest, most important function of the web and of hypertext is links and linking things to each other. As you can see from that world's first website that we had pulled up, it's all about links, and there's links to the summary of the projects, and there's links to software products. And these are what makes the web work. So here's an old web browser, Mosaic, classic. Now let's compare that to the modern web. For example, we looked at the Space Jam website. Let's check out the Interstellar website. First of all, it takes quite a bit longer to load. Starts up with a video here. Check it out. We've got all sorts of wipey effects and dynamic content, and we can open a gallery and it fades in and out. And the web now is a little bit different than it used to be. Here's CNN. You can look if you want to at the CNN OJ Simpson website. That was preserved also by CNN. So you can check things out and check out breaking news. Other things you can do just in pure web technology, HTML5. I can ride LineWriter, and I'm going to give it a try. I'm terrible. Whoop. Oh, look at this. Look at that. And I'm dead. Okay, that is all done in HTML5, in CSS, in the web technologies that we have today. So the modern web is quite a bit different than what we saw in Web 2.0. First of all, there's a lot more CSS and JavaScript. There's a lot more understanding of what makes design work and what makes a web page look nice. And through CSS and JavaScript, there's a lot more ability to make the web look that way. There's more dynamic content. There's more interaction. I can comment on a web page. I can like a page. I can share pages. There's the social web, which is significantly different from original older websites. And there's real-time content that gets updated hourly, minutely, secondly. So let's go back and look. So if you'll remember, we looked at the source of the original web page. Let's look at the source at CNN.com. Look at that. That is kind of, I can't make it any bigger, but oh yes, so this is a little bit different than the source of the web page that we looked at, of the original web page. There's quite a bit more content in the source of this document and a whole lot of other information that's needed to make a modern web page look the way a modern web page looks. So a lot of differences in the web. What's similar? There's so many still similarities. For one, the web is still all about links. Now, there's differences in the way that we distribute those links. There's differences in the way that those links are created. The social web, the social networks allow us to instantly share and create new links between sites. But it's still all about links. There's also still HTML. It's a different version of HTML. Now we're moving on to HTML5 and those new technologies and CSS3 and those new technologies. But the document creation language is still more or less the same. And so the web, while very different from what it was, in a lot of ways is very similar to the way that it was in the 90s. So HTTP, the Hypertext Transfer Protocol version 1.1, is the most common version of HTTP today. It was finalized in 1997. It's still the most common. I think the most recent number I saw was about 94% of websites use HTTP 1.1. So this is one of our big standards. It uses TCP port 80. It uses 443 if you want to use HTTPS, if you want to encrypt your content. Let's open up now Wireshark. Wrong folder. Let's open up Wireshark and take a look at HTTP. If I look at HTTP 1.1, this is an HTTP request from me to an unencrypted website. And I had to make sure it was unencrypted because otherwise we wouldn't have been able to see very much. But we can open this up and we can check it out. We've got source and destination IP addresses and all that information. And we can look, and the very first thing that's sent here is Hypertext Transfer Protocol. And this is an HTTP GET request for home/welcome.html. And the host there is home.mcom.com. And all of this information allows HTTP to work. And every time you visit a website, there's at least one HTTP GET request, more likely dozens. If you're on a very dynamic website like CNN, maybe even hundreds of HTTP GET requests to pull down all of the resources that make that website function. The HTML, that is the content of the page, the JavaScript, the CSS, the images, and everything that goes into making that website look the way that it does. And we can open up the HTTP GET request and see the method and the URI and the request version currently still using HTTP 1.1. In response from the server back to me, the next line here is an HTTP response message. And this is uses the status code 200, the response phrase of OK. And then down here, we've got the data, which if we expand that, is the content of this page. Now remember, I specifically selected a web page that used HTTP because an HTTPS web page, we wouldn't be able to see in Wireshark the content of that page. But in HTTPS, or in HTTP we can, in HTTPS we cannot. And here we've got the continuation, the rest of the web page. Here we've got a separate GET request for tiles.gif, the background of the web page. Another GET request for favicon.ico, another piece of content for that web page. And this one is responded instead of with an HTTP OK, responds with a 404, meaning that image that was requested was not found. So that's that in Wireshark. That's what the web looks like at the network level. So we've already showed it. It begins with an HTTP request, and your browser creates that HTTP request when you tell it what web page to visit. And that includes the method, whether it's a GET or the other HTTP methods that we can use, the URI, the Uniform Resource Identifier that tells us what we're looking for, what piece of content, because everything else up to HTTP only gets us to the application. It doesn't tell us, it doesn't tell the server what piece of content it needs to deliver, what piece of content we're requesting. So the URI in the HTTP request tells the server what to send us, and then the request version number. So the one that we looked at was HTTP 1.1. In response, we get, again, the request version. We get a status code that either 200 or 404, and there's dozens of other status codes that the server can respond with. And then finally, if the request is successful, then we can get the content of that HTTP response. So whatever content we indicated we wanted with the URI is sent back in that HTTP response. So as far as HTTP methods, these are not the only ones, but these are the most common ones. GET is by far the most common, and that's what you're using. That's what you're using in your browser every time you click a web page or click a link or open your home page or basically anything is typically going to be a GET request. And that's for requesting information from a server. A POST, on the other hand, is for sending information to the server. And so if you're uploading images, that's going to be through an HTTP POST request. HTTP POST request. And last one we want to talk about here is HTTP delete. Typically, you're going to restrict who has access to the HTTP delete command, but that is used to delete resources on the server. Status codes, we can open up this link and take a look at the HTTP status codes. There's a whole bunch of them. 200 again is okay. You probably recognize 404, not found. If the requested resource is not found, you're going to get a 404, and that's that HTTP status code built into the HTTP specification. There's others for moving. So if you've moved a resource, your server can respond with a 301 to indicate that it's in a different location. It can also respond with a 307, which is a redirect. Instead of telling it moved, it's redirecting there. There's lots of status codes. Again, the most common ones you're going to see are probably 200. You're probably familiar already with the 404. So after HTTP 1.1, we've got new stuff, because HTTP 1.1 is from 1997. And like we said, the web has changed pretty significantly from 1997 to today. And so just recently, just in 2015, the new specification for HTTP 2 was finalized and published. So there are several important differences. A lot of the functionality remains more or less the same. But there's a few important things, a few important changes that I want you to know about. For one, it's mostly encrypted. And the reason it's mostly encrypted is because nowadays it's important that information is encrypted, and it's beyond encrypted. Security certificates provide a lot of other benefits. And so the web browsers, the major web browsers, Chrome and Firefox and Safari, have all indicated that they will not send HTTP2 requests unless they can be encrypted. So that means that this is a de facto standard. There's no governing body that has said it. You could create your own browser that will send HTTP2 requests unencrypted, but by virtue of all of the major browsers saying they will only use encrypted HTTP2 requests, this is now the de facto standard. It's also compressed by default. It allows the ability to compress content through the wire, saving bandwidth for that. It allows servers to push content. So I already mentioned that when you use HTTP 1.1, every bit of that page is going to be a separate HTTP GET request. If you load an image, it's a GET request. If you load a JavaScript file, it's a GET request. If you load CSS, it's a GET request. And every little bit of that page needs a separate request. HTTP2 allows servers to push content, meaning if I request CNN.com, CNN.com can respond with all of the images and CSS and JavaScript and everything that I need to load the homepage. It can respond to one request with 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or 100 pieces of content that are used to make that page. So rather than forcing me to request each of those pieces of content one at a time, the server can push all of those to me in response to a single request. So that allows just that single connection from a browser to a server rather than forcing me to create dozens of connections and requests to load a simple web page. And that is the web. So I'll load the links that I have in the slides here down below so that you can check them out for yourself. Check out the old web pages, check out and compare the modern web pages, check out the source code and see what some of the differences are between the source code of older websites and the source code of modern websites.